I would like to extend a warm greeting to every woman who is listening to this recording. My teaching this afternoon is titled Abigail and is taken from 1 Samuel chapter 25. Many of us are probably familiar with the story of Abigail, Nabal, and David, but I think it might prove to be a blessing to examine the story a little further, especially from the perspective of Abigail. If you are not familiar with the story, it might be a good idea to pause the recording right now and to read through the whole chapter. It will only take a few minutes. As you listen to this teaching, I ask you to please use your imaginations to put yourselves in Abigail's place, to imagine what it must have been like to be her, to try to think what she would have thought, to try to feel what she would have felt. Since I will be dealing with the whole of chapter 25 of 1 Samuel, I will be dividing the chapter into three sections. Before I read the first section of verses, I would like to dedicate this teaching to every Christian woman who finds herself in a marriage that perhaps for decades has been a source of great pain and sorrow and discouragement to her. And I hope and pray that God will use this teaching to be a comfort and an encouragement to each one who is listening today. 1 Samuel chapter 25, verses 1 through 17. Hear the word of the Lord. Now Samuel died, and all Israel assembled and mourned for him. And they buried him in his house at Ramah. Then David rose and went down to the wilderness of Paran. And there was a man in Maon whose business was in Carmel. The man was very rich. He had 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats. He was shearing his sheep in Carmel. Now the name of the man was Nabal, and the name of his wife, Abigail. The woman was discerning and beautiful, but the man was harsh and badly behaved. He was a Calebite. David heard in the wilderness that Nabal was shearing his sheep. So David sent 10 young men, and David said to the young men, "Go up to Carmel and go to Nabal and greet him in my name. And thus you shall greet him. Peace be to you, and peace be to your house, and peace be to all that you have. I hear that you have shearers. Now your shepherds have been with us, and we did them no harm, and they missed nothing all the time they were in Carmel. Ask your young men, and they will tell you. Therefore, let my young men find favor in your eyes, for we come on a feast day. Please give whatever you have at hand to your servants and to your son David." When David's young men came, they said all this to Nabal in the name of David, and then they waited. And Nabal answered David's servants, "Who is David? Who is the son of Jesse? There are many servants these days who are breaking away from their masters. Shall I take my bread and my water and my meat that I have killed for my shearers and give it to men who come from I do not know where?" So David's young men turned away and came back and told him all this. And David said to his men, "Every man strap on his sword." And every man of them strapped on his sword. David also strapped on his sword. And about 400 men went up after David, while 200 remained with the baggage. But one of the young men told Abigail, Nabal's wife, "Behold, David sent messengers out of the wilderness to greet our master, and he railed at them. Yet the men were very good to us, and we suffered no harm, and we did not miss anything when we were in the fields as long as we went with them. They were a wall to us both by night and by day, all the while we were with them keeping the sheep. Now therefore know this and consider what you should do, for harm is determined against our master and against all his house, and he is such a worthless man that one cannot speak to him." Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this beautiful story of Abigail that you have given to us in your word. Lord, I thank you for how you have used this story in a powerful way in my own life. And Lord, I ask you to please use Abigail and her story to be a great blessing and encouragement to every precious woman who is listening today. And Lord, I ask you to please fill me continuously with your spirit as I am teaching. Thank you for this teaching that you have given to me. Lord, please empower me to give it in a manner that pleases and honors and glorifies you. In Jesus' precious name I pray, amen. We know from previous chapters in the book of 1 Samuel that God had taken the kingdom away from King Saul because of his disobedience and had given it to David, and that it was only a matter of time before David's rule over all Israel would be established. King Saul resists and fights against this decision from the Lord. So David and his men are in the wilderness because of the king's repeated attempts upon David's life. In the wilderness, David and his men meet up with some shepherds who are keeping the sheep of a man named Nabal. The shepherds go along with David, and David and his men guard the shepherds and the sheep from all harm. David hears in the wilderness that Nabal is shearing his sheep, and he sends 10 young men to Nabal on a feast day to ask him to give whatever he has at hand to David and his men. Before we examine Nabal's response to these messengers, I would like to take some time to consider what this whole chapter says about Nabal and his character, and also what this chapter says about his wife Abigail and her character. We know from verses 2 and 3 that Nabal is very rich, that he has 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats, and also that he is harsh and badly behaved. In verse 17, Nabal is described by one of his servants as such a worthless man that one cannot speak to him. Even his wife Abigail calls him a worthless fellow in verse 25. What comes to mind when we think of the word worthless? Perhaps we think of something that has no value or worth and that is useless. But the Hebrew phrase that is translated as worthless to describe Nabal in verses 17 and 25 has a much deeper meaning and significance than that. The Hebrew phrase is literally son of Belial. Belial is another name for Satan. So Nabal is literally called a son of Satan. This Hebrew phrase, translated as worthless, is also used to describe the priests Hophni and Phinehas in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 12, who did not know the Lord. Hophni and Phinehas sinned greatly against the Hophni and Phinehas sinned greatly in the sight of the Lord regarding the sacrifices, and they also lay with the women who were serving at the entrance to the tent of meeting. It was the Lord's will to put them to death, just as we will see later on in this chapter that it will be the Lord's will to put Nabal to death. The word worthless is also used in Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 13, to describe those who draw away others from the true and living God to go and serve other gods. And the word worthless is used in other places in Scripture as well, to describe those who stir up others to insurrection, who are sexually immoral, and who are liars. Not only is Nabal described as a worthless man, he is also a fool. His name means fool, and his wife says about him in verse 25, "For as his name is, so is he. Nabal is his name, and folly is with him." What comes to mind when we think of someone who is a fool? Perhaps we think of someone who makes poor and unwise choices, someone who lacks good judgment. But the word fool in Scripture has a much deeper meaning and significance than that. To call someone a fool is really to pass a moral judgment upon that person. Psalm 14, verse 1 states that the fool says in his heart, "There is no God." This is not speaking of intellectual stupidity. There are highly intelligent scientists who believe that God does not exist. Scripture calls these scientists fools. The fool is someone who is blind and oblivious to the true nature of reality. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 14 says that the wise person has his eyes in his head, but the fool walks in darkness. Nabal is a fool, and we will see later on by his response to David's messengers that he does not see reality as it truly is, that he does not perceive God's choice of David as the next ruler over all Israel. We also learn from verse 36 that Nabal is extravagant, wasteful, an intemperate man who gets very drunk, and who is proud, arrogant, selfish, and self-centered. Nabal is just the kind of man that any woman would want to have as her husband, right? The only positive things that are said about him in the whole chapter are that he is very rich, has 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats, and that he is shearing his sheep. So maybe he was hardworking and attentive to his business and affairs. Now, what about his wife Abigail? She is described in verse 3 as being discerning and beautiful. Someone who is discerning perceives clearly, has or shows good judgment, and understands a distinction. We see later on in the chapter that not only is Abigail discerning and beautiful, she is also wise, generous, courageous, godly, spiritually perceptive, humble, self-denying, sacrificial, submissive, and completely surrendered to the Lord's will for her life. Abigail knows and fears the Lord and clearly perceives the Lord's choice of David as the ruler over all, as the next ruler over all Israel. Abigail is the Lord's daughter, and Nabal is a son of Satan, and yet they are bound together in marriage till death do them part. How did this happen? How in the world did someone like Abigail come to be married to someone like Nabal? Just as King Saul in the book of 1 Samuel gives his daughters in marriage to whomever he wills, so also Abigail had probably been given in marriage to Nabal by her father or by another relative who very possibly had been attracted by Nabal's great wealth and had overlooked his glaring character defects, or perhaps had not even cared about them at all. Whoever gave Abigail to Nabal to be his wife sinned greatly against God and her and made a very poor and foolish decision. I wonder if Abigail even knew of Nabal's character before she married him. I want to take a minute to pause and to ask every married woman to remember back with me to the time before we were married. If we were to be honest with each other, many, if not all of us, had dreams of falling in love, getting married, and being loved and cherished so truly and tenderly and faithfully by our husband. Think of the beautiful book of the Song of Solomon in the Bible. Think of how the Shulamite delights in her beloved and dreams about the wedding and what will follow after. The hearts of women have not changed even after the passing of so many years. I am sure that Abigail had these same dreams and desires in her heart before she was given in marriage to Nabal. Imagine her great horror and shock when she discovered pretty quickly, probably even on the wedding night, the type of man to whom she had been joined for life. If the phrase one flesh given in Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, describes the intimacy and the solidarity that characterizes the marriage relationship, what must it have been like for someone like Abigail to be one flesh with someone like Nabal? There would have been no spiritual intimacy and communion between them at all. As 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 15 states clearly, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? What accord has Christ with Belial? Or what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? And due to this lack of spiritual intimacy and to the fact of how diametrically opposed their beliefs, characters, tastes, and outlooks on life were, there could have been no intellectual and emotional intimacy between them either, and the physical aspect of their relationship must have been highly repugnant and distasteful to Abigail. At the time that this narrative begins in 1 Samuel chapter 25, we do not know how long Abigail and Nabal have been married and if they have had any children together. But we do know that her marriage to Nabal must have been a source of continual pain, sorrow, discouragement, and embarrassment to Abigail. This is the state of the relationship between Abigail and Nabal when David sends 10 young men to Nabal on a feast day to ask him to give whatever he has on hand to David and his men. Now, let's consider Nabal's response to David's messengers in verses 9 through 11, which state, when David's young men came, They said all this to Nabal in the name of David, and then they waited. And Nabal answered David's servants, "Who is David? Who is the son of Jesse? There are many servants these days who are breaking away from their masters. Shall I take my bread and my water and my meat that I have killed from my shearers and give it to men who come from I do not know where?" Nabal does not say all of these words in an indifferent or nonchalant tone. We learn later on in verse 14 that Nabal railed at the messengers that David sent to him. The Hebrew verb translated into English as railed signifies to shriek or to fly at something and has a close relation to the Hebrew noun for birds of prey. Nabal's response to David's messengers would have been ferocious and fierce. He shrieks at them, "Who is David? Who is the son of Jesse?" These were ludicrous questions in light of the fact that all Israel would have heard of David and how he had killed Goliath, the Philistine giant. Even people outside of Israel, especially the Philistines, knew who David was and recognized that he was going to be the next king. In 1 Samuel chapter 21, when David flees from Saul to Achish, the king of Gath, the servants of Achish say in verse 11, "Is not this David, the king of the land? Did they not sing to one another of him in dances? Saul has struck down his thousands and David his 10,000s." And also, all Israel would have heard of David's great successes in battle. 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 16 says, "But all Israel and Judah loved David, for he went out and came in before them." And in verse 30 of the same chapter, it says, "Then the princes of the Philistines came to battle, and as often as they came out, David had more success than all the servants of Saul, so that his name was highly esteemed." David's name would have been on the mind and the tongue of every Israelite, from the least to the greatest. Nabal was not living under a rock. He was a very wealthy and great man. He certainly had heard of David and knew who he was. But just as the atheist really knows that God exists but suppresses the truth in unrighteousness, Nabal willfully and foolishly blinds himself to the truth and reality of David's identity and hardens his heart towards him. Nabal does not have the spiritual perception to recognize God's anointing and choice of David as the next ruler over all Israel. Nabal truly is a fool. Not only does Nabal greatly insult David by shrieking, "Who is David? Who is the son of Jesse?" he also insults him by implying that David is a servant who has unlawfully broken away from his master. Notice the contrast between Nabal's insolence and David's great humility. In the message that David sent to Nabal, he calls himself Nabal's son, and his men, Nabal's servants, addressing himself to Nabal with an attitude of deference and respect. Nabal goes on to demonstrate more of his folly by saying in verse 11, "Shall I take my bread and my water and my meat that I have killed for my shearers and give it to men who come from I do not know where?" blind and oblivious to the truth and reality, that all that he has been given to him by God and really belongs to God, Nabal calls his the meat and bread and water that he is going to give to his shearers, and selfishly and stingily refuses to share these things with David and his hungry men. He also blinds and hardens himself to the reality that David and his men have been protecting his sheep and shepherds from harm all the while that they were with them in the wilderness. When David hears of Nabal's foolish and insulting response to his messengers, he tells every man who is with him to strap on his sword. David also straps on his sword, and about 400 men go up after David, while 200 men remain with the baggage. As they are on their way to go and wreak vengeance upon Nabal, one of Nabal's young men wisely tells Abigail what has happened and urges her to consider what she should do, because harm is determined against Nabal and all his house, and he is such a worthless man that one cannot speak to him. This brings us to our second section of the chapter, which is verses 18 through 35, which state, "Then Abigail made haste and took 200 loaves and 2 skins of wine and 5 sheep already prepared and 5 seahs of parched grain and 100 clusters of raisins and 200 cakes of figs, and laid them on donkeys. And she said to her young men, 'Go on before me. Behold, I come after you.' But she did not tell her husband Nabal. And as she rode on the donkey and came down under cover of the mountain, behold, David and his men came down toward her, and she met them. Now David had said, 'Surely in vain have I guarded all that this fellow has in the wilderness, so that nothing was missed of all that belonged to him, and he has returned me evil for good. God do so to the enemies of David, and more also, if by morning I leave so much as one male of all who belonged to him.' When Abigail saw David, she hurried and got down from the donkey and fell before David on her face and bowed to the ground. She fell at his feet and said, 'On me alone, my Lord, be the guilt. Please let your servant speak in your ears and hear the words of your servant. Let not my Lord regard this worthless fellow Nabal, for as his name is, so is he. Nabal is his name, and folly is with him. But I, your servant, did not see the young men of my Lord whom you sent. Now then, my Lord, as the Lord lives, and as your soul lives, because the Lord has restrained you from blood guilt, and from saving with your own hand, now then let your enemies and those who seek to do evil to my Lord be as Nabal. And now let this present that your servant has brought to my Lord be given to the young men who follow my Lord. Please forgive the trespass of your servant, for the Lord will certainly make my Lord a sure house, because my Lord is fighting the battles of the Lord, and evil shall not be found in you so long as you live. If men rise up to pursue you and to seek your life, the life of my Lord shall be bound in the bundle of the living, in the care of the Lord your God. And the lives of your enemies he shall sling out as from the hollow of a sling. And when the Lord has done to my Lord according to all the good that he has spoken concerning you, and has appointed you prince over Israel, my Lord shall have no cause of grief or pangs of conscience for having shed blood without cause, or for my Lord working salvation himself. And when the Lord has dealt well with my Lord, then remember your servant. And David said to Abigail, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who sent you this day to meet me. Blessed be your discretion, and blessed be you, who have kept me this day from blood guilt and from working salvation with my own hand. For as surely as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, who has restrained me from hurting you, unless you had hurried and come to meet me, truly by morning there had not been left to Nabal so much as one male." Then David received from her hand what she had brought him, and he said to her, "Go up in peace to your house. See, I have obeyed your voice, and I have granted your petition." David is angry, and rightly so. He has done great good to Nabal, and Nabal is repaying him with evil. Yet this does not make it right for David to take vengeance into his own hands. As Abigail will remind him in verse 28, David was called to fight the Lord's battles, not to avenge personal insults against himself. If God had permitted David to do what he wanted to do, he not only would have taken the life of Nabal, the man who had insulted him, he also would have taken the lives of every innocent male belonging to Nabal, who had had nothing whatsoever to do with Nabal's foolish refusal to give to David and his men. David truly would have had blood guilt upon his hands. Thankfully, the Lord sends Abigail to him to plead with him on Nabal's behalf. Notice Abigail's great humility. She is a beautiful woman, the wife of a very rich man, and yet she falls at David's feet on her face and bows to the ground before him. In contrast to Nabal, who had insultingly implied that David was a servant who had unlawfully broken away from his master, in contrast to him, Abigail calls herself David's servant no less than 6 times. Abigail is completely innocent regarding Nabal's sin, and yet she says to David, "On me alone, my Lord, be the guilt," attributing Nabal's sin to herself. And she even asks David to please forgive her for her trespass, a trespass which she never even committed. Abigail is so courageous. She does not know what will happen. She does not know how David will respond to her words and to the present that she has brought to him. She does not know if God will give her favor in David's eyes. She is taking a huge risk. In his great anger and desire for vengeance, David might even take her life. Abigail is willing to risk and lay down her life for the sake of others. She is even willing to lay down her life for the man who had probably caused her nothing but pain ever since the first day they were married. Does Abigail remind you of someone? I believe that Abigail is an Old Testament figure who foreshadows and typifies the coming person and work of Jesus Christ. She takes all of Nabal's sin and all of his guilt upon herself when she is completely innocent and without blame. Jesus Christ was completely innocent and without sin, and yet he took all of our sin and all of our guilt upon himself on the cross and paid the penalty for our sins that we deserved. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 states, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Abigail mediates between two parties at hostility and enmity with each other. Jesus Christ mediates between God the Father and fallen humanity. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 states, "For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus." Abigail intercedes for Nabal, the guilty party, someone who does not deserve to be pardoned for his sin. She pleads with David on behalf of Nabal. Jesus Christ intercedes with God the Father on behalf of his people. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25 says of Jesus, "Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them." Not only does Abigail foreshadow and typify the coming person and work of Christ, she also believes all that the Lord has spoken regarding David. She perceives clearly and understands that God has appointed David to be the next ruler over all Israel. And she asks David to remember her when this has occurred. I think what Abigail means by asking him to remember her is the following: that when God finally establishes David on the royal throne over all Israel, and he has the power and the authority to take Nabal's life, she is asking David to remember her and what she has said and done today, and to show mercy to Nabal and to all his household. God gives Abigail great favor in David's eyes. In contrast to Nabal, who is such a worthless man that one cannot speak to him, David is a man with whom one can reason, a man who will listen to wise counsel and receive a rebuke. David recognizes the sinfulness of what he had been about to do and blesses the Lord for sending Abigail to him. He also blesses Abigail for keeping him from blood guilt and from avenging himself with his own hand. He receives the present from her hand, puts an end to his vengeful desires and plans, and sends Abigail up to her house in peace. This brings us to our last section of the chapter, which is verses 36 through 44, which state, "And Abigail came to Nabal, and behold, he was holding a feast in his house, like the feast of a king. And Nabal's heart was merry within him, for he was very drunk. So she told him nothing at all until the morning light. In the morning, when the wine had gone out of Nabal, his wife told him these things, and his heart died within him, and he became as a stone. And about 10 days later, the Lord struck Nabal, and he died. When David heard that Nabal was dead, he said, "Blessed be the Lord, who has avenged the insult I received at the hand of Nabal, and has kept back his servant from wrongdoing. The Lord has returned the evil of Nabal on his own head." Then David sent and spoke to Abigail to take her as his wife. When the servants of David came to Abigail at Carmel, they said to her, "David has sent us to you to take you to him as his wife." And she rose and bowed with her face to the ground and said, "Behold, your handmaid is a servant to wash the feet of the servants of my Lord." And Abigail hurried and rose and mounted a donkey, and her five young women attended her. She followed the messengers of David and became his wife. David also took Ahinoam of Jezreel, and both of them became his wives. Saul had given Michal, his daughter, David's wife, to Palti, the son of Laish, who was of Galim. When Abigail comes to Nabal, he is holding a feast in his house like the feast of a king. The food and drink that Nabal could have given to David and his hungry men, he instead lavishly spreads out for himself in his house in a feast as if he was a king, when David is going to be the true king. When Abigail comes to Nabal, he is very drunk, so she does not tell him what she has done until the morning arrives and he is sober. When Nabal hears what she has done, his heart dies within him. He becomes as a stone, and about 10 days later, the Lord strikes him and he dies. Was Abigail justified in going to meet David and giving him such a large present without first consulting with her husband? Shouldn't a wife first confer with her husband before doing something on such a large scale? Ordinarily, the answer would be yes. A wife should consult first with her husband, for he is the leader and the head of the household. But in this case, Abigail knew that her husband's life and other lives were in danger, and that her husband was not a man who would listen to argument and reason, and that she must act quickly to save the lives of all of the males of her household. She goes against her husband's wishes and acts without his knowledge. But in light of the fact that she recognized God's choice of David as the next ruler over all Israel, I believe that she does what is right and that this is a case of obeying God rather than men. It must have been a very fearful thing for Abigail to tell Nabal what she had done. Nabal was a harsh and badly behaved man. Remember how he railed at the messengers that David sent to him out of the wilderness. Nabal must have been harsh and badly behaved towards Abigail on a daily and consistent basis. I wonder what he would have said and done to Abigail if God had not caused his heart to die within him and then taken his life about 10 days later. By taking Nabal's life, God delivers Abigail from her very painful and loveless marriage. But the deliverance ends up being bittersweet for Abigail, as we will soon see. By taking Nabal's life, God also avenges the insult that David had received at Nabal's hand. When David hears of Nabal's death, he blesses God for this and for the fact that the Lord had restrained him from executing vengeance with his own hands. He also sends to take Abigail as his wife. David has only seen Abigail once. He has only spoken with her one time before he sends for her to become his wife. This tells us that he must have been incredibly struck by and impressed not only with her beauty, but also with her courage, godliness, spiritual perception, generosity, and her humble, self-denying, and sacrificial spirit. Abigail's great humility shines forth again when she learns that David wants her to become his wife. Verse 41 states, "And she rose and bowed with her face to the ground and said, 'Behold, your handmaid is a servant to wash the feet of the servants of my Lord.'" We know that at the time when Jesus was on earth, the task of washing feet was usually assigned to the lowliest member of the household. If this was true at the time when Abigail was living, then Abigail assigns to herself the lowliest position and the lowliest of tasks. She calls herself a servant to wash the feet of the servants of David. I would like to confess to you that I feel so impressed with and inspired by Abigail's great humility and so convicted of the pride and the arrogance that are in my own heart and that come out in my words and my actions. I truly admire Abigail very much, and I greatly desire to be humble like her. Lately, when I have been tempted to be proud and disrespectful, I have remembered Abigail's great humility, and the Lord has used her life and her story and her example to help and empower me to be humble in the present. And not only is Abigail humble, she is also completely surrendered and submissive to the Lord's will for her life. As soon as David sends to take her to become his wife, she bows in humility to the ground and hurries to obey his summons. Abigail shines brightly throughout this whole chapter, with nothing negative being said about her either here or anywhere else where she is mentioned in the Bible. I think Abigail is one of the most beautiful women of God in all of Scripture. And this is why my heart breaks for her when I come to verse 43 and read what David does. Verse 43 states that David also took Ahinoam of Jezreel, and both of them became his wives. David's first wife, Michal, has been given by King Saul to another man in David's absence, and David now has the opportunity to make a decision that will set the trajectory of his future life. I believe that this was a very crucial moment in David's life. David was not a fool like Nabal. David was a man who worshiped and served and feared God, a man after God's own heart. Yet his decision to take another wife in addition to Abigail was one of the most foolish decisions that he made in his whole life. Abigail would have been any godly man's dream girl. She was wise, generous, discerning, godly, courageous, sacrificial, spiritually perceptive, humble, submissive, and beautiful. In contrast to David's first wife, Michal, who in 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 16, despises David in her heart for leaping and dancing before the Lord. In contrast to her, Abigail was a woman with whom David could have true and deep spiritual, intellectual, emotional, and physical intimacy and communion. He and Abigail would have been able to worship and serve and fear God together. They would have been able to pray together and to talk about the Lord together. Their souls would have shared the deepest intimacy and communion because of the strong faith and trust that they both had in the Lord. By giving Abigail to David, God was giving him a beautiful blessing and a beautiful treasure of great and inestimable worth. Yet David did not seem to appreciate and value the great and beautiful treasure and blessing that God had given to him. He was not content and satisfied with Abigail, but wanted more. Isn't this true of our hearts as well? And not only does David take Ahinoam of Jezreel to be his wife, by the time we come to 2 Samuel chapter 3, verses 2 through 5, we read that David has taken four more wives in addition to Ahinoam and Abigail, and we also read later on in that chapter that David's first wife, Michal, is returned to him. And in 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 13, we read that David took more concubines and wives from Jerusalem after he came from Hebron. And of course, in 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 27, we read that Bathsheba also becomes David's wife. So many wives, so many women. When David had everything that he ever could have needed in one woman alone, in Abigail. From the beginning, God's design has been for marriage to be between one man and one woman. Genesis chapter 2, verse 24 says, "Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." When God made a helper fit for Adam, he fashioned one woman and brought her to him. By taking all of these wives and all of these concubines, David was going against God's perfect and beautiful design, established from the very beginning. What if David had chosen to be content and satisfied with Abigail? What if he had chosen to seek for marital love, intimacy, communion, and delight in her and her alone? Not only would this have brought him true and great happiness, but also so much evil could have been prevented, such as the murder of Bathsheba's husband Uriah the Hittite, Amnon's rape of Tamar, and Absalom's revolt. You can read about these things in 2 Samuel chapters 11, 13, and 15. I feel so sad for Abigail. Her first husband Nabal certainly did not value and appreciate her. And her second husband, David, who had the ability and the capacity to value her, shows by his subsequent actions and decisions that he did not truly value her either. But based upon what we know from 1 Samuel chapter 25 of Abigail's very godly character and conduct, we can be assured that as David took on each additional wife, and Abigail's place and importance in his heart grew less and less, we can be assured that Abigail continued faithful and true to God, that she continued to be a very discerning, wise, humble, godly, submissive, and self-denying woman. I think so often we read through the Bible stories and forget that these were real women with real hearts, thoughts, and feelings. Before preparing this teaching, I do not think I thought very much about Abigail. I probably had read her story a number of times throughout my life, but I do not remember being deeply impressed with and impacted by it. But now, Abigail has become a great heroine of the faith to me, and a very beautiful and powerful example of remaining true and faithful to God, no matter what painful and difficult circumstances I find myself in. And I hope and pray that she is an inspiration and encouragement to you as well. If Abigail could remain faithful and true to God, even being married to such a man as Nabal, how much more can you and I, by God's grace, walk uprightly and remain true to the Lord, no matter what discouragements and difficulties we face? From the day that she married Nabal, Abigail's pain, sorrow, and disappointment must have been great and continual, and she did not know how long her marriage to Nabal would last. For all that she knew, she and Nabal might both live for several more decades, and during that time, he might never change, but only get worse and worse and descend further and further into sin and darkness. The future must have loomed before her as unending and filled with constant pain. And yet, by God's grace, Abigail did not rebel against the Lord. She did not shake her fist at the Lord and walk away from him. She did not become bitter or filled with self-pity or hatred. Abigail did not make herself miserable because of Nabal's sins. She did not turn to food or drink or commit adultery or take her own life. I am sure that she must have had some very dark moments in which she felt like giving up. But God gave her the grace and the strength to take refuge in him and to walk uprightly and humbly before him, to fear him and serve him and live for him with her whole heart. Lately, when I have been in pain or have been discouraged by difficult circumstances, I have remembered Abigail's story and her life. And God has used her to be a great encouragement to me in the suffering that I am experiencing. And I truly hope that the Lord will use her life and her story in a powerful way in your lives as well, in whatever suffering and trials that you are facing. Not only do Abigail's life and story encourage us in the difficulties that we face, I believe that her marriage to Nabal also holds a strong warning to any Christian woman who is contemplating or planning on marrying an unbeliever. As stated earlier, Abigail probably had no say regarding the decision that was made for her to marry Nabal. She probably had been given in marriage to him by her father or another relative. But here in the United States of America, in the 21st century, you and I are the ones who choose who we will marry. Of course, submitting this choice to the Lord's leading and will. I would like to urge every unmarried Christian woman to take seriously God's command given in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 16b, which state, "Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? What accord has Christ with Belial? Or what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God." As Christian women, we should not even consider non-Christian men as options for dating and marriage. We should not even let crushes and feelings for them take root and flourish in our hearts. I will confess to you that before falling in love with and marrying my husband, I have had crushes before on unbelievers, especially one big secret crush on a close friend I used to have when I was in high school. And when you have a crush on someone, it is very hard to think clearly. I was a Christian at the time, and he was an unbeliever, and yet I foolishly let my feelings for him cultivate in my heart and take root there, not just for months, but throughout the high school years and even after high school. Thankfully, I never told him about my feelings for him, and he never asked me out, so our relationship just remained a friendship. But I know that if he had asked me out, and if I had chosen to disobey God's command, God's clear command, by dating him and marrying him, based upon what I know of his post-high school lifestyle and behavior, I know for sure that our marriage would have been a disaster and my life would have been filled with misery and heartbreak. And most importantly, my walk with the Lord would have been greatly and deeply affected. I praise and thank God for protecting me from all of that suffering and pain, and for blessing me with a wonderful Christian husband who loves him and knows him and wants to live for him. Our marriage is very far from perfect, and there are many ways in which we both need to change and grow. But at the deepest level of intimacy, the spiritual level, we share deep communion and union because of the faith, the strong faith and trust that we both have in the Lord. We can pray together. We can worship and serve God together. We can talk about the Lord and His Word together. And we see and understand all of life through the lens of Scripture. And we both know for sure that we will be together forever in the new heavens and the new earth. These are inestimable blessings that you will not enjoy if you marry a man who is an unbeliever and who remains an unbeliever throughout his entire life. I think so often we focus on the negative aspects of God's commands. Do not, you shall not, etc. And we think that God is restricting our freedoms. when actually God's commands and laws are for our protection and also for our highest happiness and delight. The command, "Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers," is to protect you and me from great suffering and pain, and to bring us the greatest good, happiness, and order in this life. God has given me the honor to hear the very painful and sad stories of several Christian women who married unbelievers and then suffered greatly for it, even for decades. I hope and pray that every unmarried Christian woman who is listening will learn from their example and take seriously God's command. If you desire to be married and feel hopeless and despairing of ever finding a wonderful Christian man, remember that God created and sustains the whole universe, and that He has the power and the ability to bless you with a godly husband if it is His will. Present your request before Him and ask Him for the grace and the strength to submit patiently to His will and His perfect timing for your life. And in the meantime, pursue the Lord passionately, for even if you end up marrying the best and godliest of husbands, you will soon realize that only God can truly and completely fulfill you and satisfy the deepest longings of your heart. And lastly, I think that the story of Abigail and Nabal and David has a very important lesson for those of us who feel tempted to take vengeance into our own hands when others insult, offend, and hurt us in any way. When others say and do evil to us, it can be very tempting to harden our hearts towards them and to repay them with evil, such as by not talking to them, not praying for them or blessing them, not giving to them or encouraging them, and even by speaking evilly about them to others. They have hurt us, so we want to hurt them back. But we must not do these things. We must always remember that it is for our highest happiness and our highest peace and joy to obey God's commands, to never repay evil with evil, and to never avenge ourselves. I would like to conclude this teaching by reading the very beautiful words of Romans chapter 12, verses 17 through 21, which God has often used to help me when I feel tempted to take vengeance into my own hands. "Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." Amen. Let's pray. Lord, I just praise you and thank you for this beautiful story of Abigail. Oh Lord, her sufferings were so great, but you were with her and you gave her the grace and the strength to remain true and faithful to you and to walk humbly and uprightly before you to the end. Lord, I pray for every precious woman who is listening today. Only you know the suffering and the pain that each one is experiencing. Lord, I ask you to please use this beautiful story of Abigail to be a great blessing and comfort and encouragement to each one of us in whatever trials and difficulties we are facing, whether it's in our marriage, our health, our family, our finances, or whatever other area of our lives. Lord, please comfort us and encourage us and give us strength. Please give us the grace to walk humbly and uprightly before you and to remain faithful and true to you until the end. We just praise you and worship you and give you all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.